let's go straight into it. This is a little topic I think I've spoken about previously in my other podcast. It's regarding the whole, like, you know, Nina Kravitz controversy with her wearing cane rolls during a recent performance that she had, I think, in Italy somewhere. It's still rumbling on. I'm not sure why. I would like to know why. I don't really know why. I think fundamentally there are a group of people out there who just you take very seriously this idea of cultural appropriation. You know, the whole, like, you know, the whole meme, you know, my culture isn't your costume, all that sort of stuff with Halloween, with that girl that wore that Chinese outfit, or the quote unquote Asian influenced, or what do you call it, like a traditional Asian outfit or something. Remember that girl on Twitter that she was wearing one of those Chung Lee sort of type outfits that you'd get, a lot more traditional than Chun-Li outfit, obviously, for Street Fighter. But and then everyone went crazy and said, you know, and there was a meme that went around, you'd be like, oh, my culture is not your costume. So I think there's some people out there who just fundamentally believe that cultural appropriation is the bane, or is another example of what do you call it, white privilege in that regard, right? In some aspect of the sense, where they believe that the fact that some people who aren't indigenous to that community can take part of it, wear it as a costume, or, you know, dip their toes in it from here and, you know, whenever they feel the need to, like stuff like hip hop, whether it comes at stuff like cane rolls, whether it comes to wearing excessive jewelry or speaking in a certain way, they feel as if, like, those cultural appropriation types are like, oh, you can do that, and then when you want to, you can just turn off the switch and go back to your white privilege cloak or white privilege safety blanket, right? Which I guess I have seen something before in that regard, because I think if you're at the front lines of fighting that cultural race war, right, or whatever it may be, then you probably see the negative side of things more often than you see the positive side of things. So you're constantly having to fight against people assuming how you people kind of, you know, having predetermined ideas about who you are as a person based on the color of your skin. So when those same people then go and try and quote unquote co-opt your culture or use it for whenever they feel necessary, like, you know, whenever they feel like it's convenient, your nose can sometimes get bent out of place. But then there's another article here again that popped up from Resident Advisor that's probably a little bit more balanced and probably has a bit more nuance to it, that obviously expounds on the topic a little bit more. And it just got me thinking in general about what is actually the issue here, because I think sometimes with these sort of things, especially when it happens to celebrities, I think the lesson that can be gleaned from it, or the insights that can be, especially if you're a pedestrian or general, you know, your average civilian on the streets, I think what you can look from, you can obviously have the, you know, knee-jerk reaction about, you know, this person's bad, that, you know, they're racist, whatever it may be. But if you look a bit deeper into it, it's usually a good indication of just the person's standing in the industry. So Nina Kravitz, obviously, is somebody that's, you know, got a long history in the techno electronic music scene. She's been somebody that hasn't been short of her own controversial issues that have come up due to her own behavior or the way that people perceive her or relationships she had in the industry. We know the Machioplex wasn't really a big fan of her, which obviously maybe is an indication of maybe how other people are towards her too. We know she had an issue with, you know, the whole, like, sexualization of herself when she did that RA video with her in the bathtub. Some comments she's made about other DJs. It's been a constant frame. I think her and Seth Troxler had a bit of an issue before back in the day. I'm not sure. There's some issues with Nina and some of the people in the industry. Some of it might have to do with the fact that, you know, for a long time she was maybe only one of a couple of high-ranking female DJs out there who are really trying to, you know, who are really playing within kind of the boys' club of electronic scene, of electronic music. So for that, you know, maybe as a defense mechanism, you get a bit prickly, you're a bit standoffish, you can be a bit curt, a bit rude, because, you know, you're the only one of a few girls in the industry, you look the way you look, you have that particular background, you know, there are things that can kind of come with it. So maybe as a defense mechanism, you kind of build up a bit of a shield and a bit of a combative nature in you. And this could be just in general, she just might be not a nice person, right? But unfortunately, like most industries, what you have to kind of contest with, especially if you're an average Joe and you're annoyed by Nina Kravitz, you have to also accept the fact that the entertainment industry, much like sports, operates a lot on who is able to bring the most, who is the big draw, right? The big draws are the ones that get preferential treatment, and also the ones that are able to deliver high quality work, right? So if you're a dickhead, if you're a real piece of shit, but you're able to bring people through the doors, you're able to put bums on seats, you can bring people to the actual rave and to the party, you sell tickets, you sell music, you sell EP single streams, you can shift merch when a big brand collaboration, when a big corporate brand puts their name next to yours, they see an uptake in impressions, you are a real needle mover, right? You move the needle, as Dana White says about UFC fighters. Then, unfortunately, you're going to have to put up, you're just going to have to tolerate them because their talent surpasses any kind of, inefficiencies they may have in their personality. And I think that might be the case with Nina Kravitz, because I think sometimes when I'm reading this issue and I'm kind of trying to, you know, dig deep and look at what the actual problem was, maybe it was her replies back to Frankie from this woman. Maybe it was the fact that she didn't really seem like she gave a shit of what anyone thought about her wearing cornrows. Maybe it's because she came across a little bit rude. I don't know what it is, but it doesn't seem to be there's much there. It seems like she wore cornrows, didn't want to apologize for it. And now it's kind of spawned op-eds and opinion pieces and fucking thousands of Twitter threads. But I don't really see the main issue. So it might just be the fact that in the behind the scenes, people have wanted to cancel or get rid of Nina Kravitz for a long time. And they probably saw this is an apt moment to do it. It's like you make a mistake and then they kind of suddenly jump on it straight away, right? So I think this is probably an aspect of it, I think, in some respects. I think you've probably seen it in your workplace, right? You probably thought everything is cool and blessed, and then you made one error, and then they've come on top of you like a ton of bricks, given you a disciplinary, told you off or some shit, called you out in front of everyone. You're like, whoa, shit, where the fuck did this come from, right? Or your partner or your spouse, right? You did something wrong in an instance, and then, you know, they pile on top of you and start mentioning all these other things you did in the past. And usually it isn't because of that one thing you did. That's the one thing is a trigger for all the other stuff that you've done in the past. And it's kind of built up all this, you know, it's brought to the surface all these pent up frustrations. So maybe this is what's going on with Nina Kravitz. People just generally don't like her and use this opportunity to kind of just, you know, get her out of the scene. But this this op-ed from Resident Advisor goes is a bit reasoned, a bit more balanced. I'll read a bit of it now and then we can just kind of, you know, fast go to the bottom and kind of read a summary of it. I won't bore you too much with it, but let's just read the couple opening paragraphs. So this is an article from Resident Advisor. It's an opinion piece. Basically their op-eds that they kind of put together, and it's deeper than cornrows, it's culture. And this is an article written by, who's the author here? By an Ash Lauren. So here's the following. Let's read this article here. This is regarding the whole Nina Kravitz cornrows debacle. So she says the following. Hope it's a she, I'm not too sure. Anyway, it's Friday post cornrow and cultural appropriation on Twitter, and man, am I exhausted. I feel like so many points were missed and simply over people's heads, and I still won't be able to touch on all of them here. As I mentioned in my first piece on this topic, this situation is much bigger than one white woman rocking cornrows and getting called out on it. The conversation is much bigger, one that will continue on much longer after this Twitter battle dissolves. Through all of this, I realize that many will still never truly understand or acknowledge things like white privilege and culture appropriation. Which is true, but again, I don't really see what the point of acknowledging of... We know white privilege and culture appropriation exist. I think some festivals and some concerts, especially in the electronic music scene, are guilty of that to some way, shape, or form. But I don't understand what do we do with that information, though? Like, what do we do? And where's the line, right? If you see a couple of kids wearing, you know, that come from the EBM, electronic body music scene, and they're wearing those kind of cyber goth punk kind of outfits with the massive combats and the tight vests and shit and all the chains and the big boots, and some of them have, you know, goggles on and they've got braids, which are probably more like similar to, like, you know, the Predator blades, like, you know, the alien Predator. But if they've got that kind of style of haircut, then what's the line that separates that and what Nina Kravitz did? All right, it's just like, I don't understand what the point of this is. It's like, it's electronic music. Music by its very nature is cultural appropriation. You're taking the best bits of other different genres and you're just kind of putting them into one massive sampling box and trying to extract the best possible sounds on it sonically, right? That's basically what culture appropriation is, and music has that from the very onset. That's effectively what sampling is, isn't it, really? I don't really see what the point is here, but anyway, what do I know? So it's just probably, they continue, there are indeed sensitive topics, trust me. I've even had fellow black people come at me negatively for speaking out on this, a couple whom I know personally. As Atlanta writer Torian Walker puts it, being taught to forgive our oppressors is the most devastating legacy white supremacy affects us with. I also want to add that simply because one or two black people give you a pass on something doesn't quite mean you're exempt from the rest of the community's concerns. Again, this is a very, very weird way to look at stuff, right? That fundamentally that we have ownership over a particular hairstyle is just absolutely insane. And I don't know what that does to progress or to get us to the point of where we want to. I wonder, do some people want to live in a post-racial world? I know I do. I want to. Don't we want to end up living in a world where there's world peace and we don't, you know, what you call it, judge each other by the, you know, by our color and creed or by our race and stuff? Like, don't we want to reach that point, that zenith, that kind of utopia? It's something, you know, it's ambitious. It's probably unlikely to happen, but I don't understand why some people are so adamant or so against operating in that kind of way of thinking, or they want to hold on so deeply to these ideas of, you know, these racial identities, and, you know, no, this is what makes me who I am, and I can't let it go. It's like, that makes you who you are, cool, but you can also share it with others. Others can also adopt those things and kind of, you know, allow that to form part of the identity, because then that means that you have more in common and you can spread your network across, you know, across the world, and not just kind of, you know, not just only concentrating on people that look like you or are from, you know, in your locale. That doesn't make any sense. That's not what we want in the future, do we? But I guess some people don't. Some people probably just want to hold on to it, because I guess if you do operate from that point of view and someone tells you you can't have that haircut or that hairstyle, then what does that leave you with, right? Probably that's probably the issue at hand here. But I don't know. Anyway, let's continue here. One more paragraph. I know that race is a sensitive subject, and being that we all know that, I think when dealing with issues of race, we need to treat them with care rather than dismissiveness. If anything, I think the one main point that was missed by many throughout all this is that the outrage didn't necessarily stem from the act of the person in question choosing to wear the hairstyle. The true outrage came once people saw with their own eyes how the person dealt with the situation. Again, that's just not really fair, isn't it, really, isn't it? Because if you honestly think you did nothing wrong, then I don't really see the problem of how Nina Kravitz replied. If she generally thinks that she has done nothing wrong, she generally thinks that everyone's freaking out over nothing, she generally thinks political correctness has gone overboard, she generally thinks woke culture is stupid, then I don't really see the issue here, because, you know, by and large, actions speak louder than words, right? We haven't heard anything or seen anything from Nina Kravitz that would give us, that would make us think that she's a racist or she holds racist point of views. Right. And if anything as well, if you're a racist, why would you want to wear cornrows anyway? You wouldn't want to associate yourself anything with, you wouldn't want any association with marginalized minority groups, would you? You'd want to completely disown it and completely separate yourself from it. And we know those people who they are, but I don't know. It's just a strange way to kind of think. Like, so it's her reply was the issue, which I kind of deduced. I thought the reply was probably the one that got her most in trouble, because she generally didn't think that she gave a shit, which again rubbed people up the wrong way. The initial response of I can wear whatever I want was deeply problematic, which is not really, because she, in theory, you can, to many people in the black community, as we could never simply wear whatever we want. Yeah, you can. It doesn't mean that. I think that's probably where the privilege comes in, right? We all have different points of privilege, and I guess if you're saying that white people can wear whatever they want and get away with it, that is probably true. If a white person was to go into an office and have braids after she came back from a holiday somewhere, I probably think there'd be more, you know, interest and, you know, in, oh, curiosity. Oh my God, that's so cool. Where do you get that done? But maybe if you're a black person wearing braids, you might get told off and you might get told to take him out and stuff. I know those issues happen, but I don't know what to say about that. Is that something that is that an institutional thing? Is that an ignorance thing? Is that like an education thing? Maybe, but what should we do? Cancel your workplace because they don't let you wear braids? Or should you be able to educate your workplace and allow them, I don't know, allow your manager to go to a workshop to find out whether or not that particular hairstyle is problematic? I don't know. It's like, what's the point of this here? Like, I think they're piling on all the ill will, all the negative feelings they have about culture appropriation and white privilege, and they're just putting it all in front doorsteps on Nina Kravitz, which isn't really fair, really. It's just a DJ, really, isn't it? It's not, I don't know what else she's going to do. Like, this ain't going to change much. And again, just go to Tomorrowland and you'll see plenty of people there with braids that aren't black, dancing to electronic music. Burning Man, same thing. Even in fucking Junction 2, there were a few girls I saw with glitter and cyborg outfits with braids on. What can we do there? I mean, we often, and it continues here, the initial response of I can wear what I want was deeply problematic to many people in the black community, as we can never simply wear what we want when it comes to our hair. We often face backlash from our workplace and judgment from the world simply for wearing our authentic styles like cornrows or dreadlocks. The concept of that in itself is something many fail to recognize. One would like to think a well-to-do white person who spent their career profiting off black music, Jesus Christ, would actually address our concerns as valid. But we also saw this was not the case there, which speaks to an even bigger issue, the idea that people can simply take what they want from black culture, then discard us and our voices when it's no longer convenient. And again, this is just unfair. I don't think she's discarded anyone's voices. Again, this kind of anger is aimed at the wrong person. I think if I was, again, I don't agree with those kind of points of views. I'm not fighting that kind of fight. I think there's a bigger fight to fight out there that, you know, might come from just representation in DJ lineups overall. I think if you're going to point your ire or point your gun at somebody, it might be to the event organizers and festival bookers out there who are continually booking the same old nonsense people to play at the same festivals year in, year out. There's not much variation in terms of people, not even in terms of just different types of people. There's not that much variation, let alone in color and creed, let alone in ages, let alone in musical background, let alone in history. Just look back at some of the old RA features about DJs, right? And interviews of some of the legendary people that they've kind of interviewed back in the day and see whether or not they've been booked lately for a big festival. No, they're only booking the people who have quite a big following on social media, people who are able to kind of garner the ticket sales. You know, there's a lot of criteria that come into it, but if you limit your selection pool to just the people who have the biggest names and who can move the needle, you're only going to have a certain group of people to pick. So it's going to be a small selection of people that do that, right? Because in every industry, there's only a small number of people who actually move majority of the tickets. Everyone else is usually in the periphery. But the responsibility of the organizers and the festival promoters out there is to introduce and to showcase different people, different sorts of talent, so that the consumers are willing and able to maybe accept, yeah, let's see. I'm happy, I don't mind seeing a Tale of Us, but also want to see another person that's new play alongside them or play before them, not the same old people, not Mashoplex again, somebody, you know what I mean, like mix up a little bit. And that's the responsibility of the festival, right? Because this isn't like, we're not talking about Coachella, we're not talking about big commercial festivals, we're talking about an industry where it's very niche, electronic music scene, especially the underground electronic music scene. You're kind of catering to the same 10,000 or so people who go to the same sort of festivals all around Europe. So you have more scope to experiment because you know you're going to sell a certain amount of tickets. So why not just, you know, you can still book the Ricardo Verlo bosses, the Jamie Jones and all these people. But then you can also expose us to different people and introduce other new talents into the scene. Whereas nowadays, what I'm seeing now is the best people get booked still, the top people get booked. But then all the up and coming guys and girls just get put on some next stage somewhere in the middle of nowhere in the same festival, you know, playing, you know, at 3 p.m. when no one's around. And that's the way that they kind of address that imbalance. And that's not really what we want, right? We want to see Up Sammy play before Nina Kravitz one time in a festival, right? Even though she's not as high a profile as Nina Kravitz, that would be a good way to kind of expose that DJ to that kind of scene, right? There's lots of people like that you want to see play, like in the mix and kind of change up. So it's not the same Martinez brothers, Seth Troxler, Jamie Jones, I don't know, those kind of contingent people playing the same places again. You want to just mix, and that will bring the best out of Martinez brothers, it'll bring the best out of Jamie Jones, bring the best out of Seth Troxler. But we don't see that. So that's the fight that needs to be concentrated on more so than white privilege. Like, this is like insane, really. It's like, what? Like, I don't get this at all. Like, this isn't Nina Kravitz's fault. This is just a consequence of her being one of the only people in the scene, or females in the scene, that's still around now, still killing it, still willing to do all the, you know, social media shit, still willing to self-promote herself, still willing to put herself out there, still willing to do these sort of, like, you know, I once called them stunts, but these things were to kind of garner reaction. That isn't, you know, it's not her fault, but we need the industry to kind of recognize that, yeah, let's mix it up. Because I think maybe deep down the frustration isn't that she's able to kind of adorn the cornrows and kind of, you know, go by her merry way. It's the fact that she's still eating really well off of this music shit, right? And some people out there have just have a bit of resentment about it, which is healthy. I'm not going to say it's right. It's not healthy. It's not some way that I would operate, but I understand the resentment because it's the same people. It doesn't change, right? It's not like a new industry coming up and kind of blowing. It's like, even the kids nowadays have to listen to the same people, which is probably why some kids lean towards EDM maybe, right? Because at least with EDM, the DJs and the fandom are quite reflective of each other, right? They look like one another. They're in the same sort of age range, same sort of interests. They kind of age each other out quite quickly. I don't think there's a lot of EDM fans who are over the age of maybe 45, maybe. It is a very much of a youth-centric industry, but electronic music scene outside of EDM, which is house, deep house, tech house in some respects, techno, it's a very much so, like, you know, even the kids coming up now, they still have to listen to Marcel Dietmann or Ben Clock. Like, they don't have their own people that they can kind of champion, which is, again, isn't their fault. It's more so the fault of the industry for not allowing people, DJs, to come up. grow with a club, grow with a label, have a residency, play the opening set of a festival, play before the final act plays as a warm-up, right? Come, like, what? Why doesn't some unknown dude play before Ben Clark at a festival? So then you get to hear this guy play instead of, you know, booking Rod Had or, you know, or Dax J or somebody. Book someone new. Even Dax J is a newish kind of dude, but book someone new and fresh so that the kids have someone else they can champion. It doesn't really happen. So maybe this is what it is deep down, just resentment. But I don't know, man. I don't know how they're going to deal with it. I think, like I said, I'm pretty sure this is probably... And also an indication of just how little people think of Nina Kravitz as a person in the industry. I think it shows that, you know, she made this one little misstep and everyone just piled on her. So it seems like maybe industry people don't generally like her. She probably doesn't have a good reputation, which, again, I'm just assuming. I'm not sure. I don't have any inside information. And if that is the case, then again, that is unfortunate too, isn't it? If you're going to, I don't know. If I didn't like somebody, I wouldn't support what they were doing. I wouldn't pile on them when they made this one error. And if anything, if we know anything about entertainment, we'll know that, you know, if that is the case and she is a shitty person, it will eventually catch up with you. We know that. It doesn't, you know, it's never not happened. If you're a dickhead and people don't like you, eventually it will catch up with you. So that's, I just say, people just let time take its course. If she's a shitty person and people don't like her, it will eventually happen. But again, I don't think this is the right way to kind of go about it personally, in my opinion. Because again, I don't think there's anything that has come from this, even through its op-ed, that tells me anything more or different than what the situation is. You know, one woman wore cornrows that no one likes. She didn't apologize, or she didn't want to apologize, and people ragged on her. It is what it is, isn't it? I think people need to just move on and kind of let her live her life. And I guess in general, as well, it's electronic music, isn't it? If you don't like what she's doing and you want to put other people on, you could always put on your own events. You could always put on your own festivals. It's going to cost you an arm and a leg. It's not going to be as easy as, you know, turning up to Junction 2 and just plugging in your USB sticks. But again, you're going to be able to kind of maybe forge your own path. That's the only way to do it, I think, in my experience. I don't think complaining on the internet about her cornrows is going to, you know, in the wider scheme of things, really going to change the direction where electronic music is going. Because for the most part, they haven't really done much, have they, really, innit? Feel they have that thing of what they want to do about 50-50 lineups, gender split, which is a really bad idea. But that's the only thing I've seen so far. Any kind of way in terms of changing the way electronic music looks or sounds or feels. It's just, no one's really moved an inch. You have a lot of girls in London putting on all-female club nights, which again are, I'd love to see what they look like inside. Are they full? Are they busy? Is it just like an exercise in political discourse? I don't know. Does that change anything? Who knows? But at least they're doing something. That's it, really. But for the major level, has Fabric done anything different? Maybe. Has XOY done anything different? Maybe. All these big clubs, have they done anything different? I don't know. And that's what needs to change. Yes, your industry attitude to things. But if we're going to waste our time talking about people's cornrows, then we're not going to get to the point of it, are we? But what do I know?